Oliver is a 40-year-old man from the United States. Oliver has a lot going for him. He's married, has two children, and is currently trying to make the step and become an entrepreneur. On the weekends, he goes biking in the mountains surrounding his hometown. He recently purchased a bike and wanted to test it on one of the familiar trails. To be safe, he put on his full body armor and helmet. As he raced down, he felt comfortable on his new bike. He was just completing a more challenging part of the route. And then it happened. He fell, and everything turned dark. When he regained consciousness, he was baffled. "What? I've never crashed on this trail. I love this trail," he thought. Then he tried to get up, but couldn't. He called the ambulance, which took him to the nearest hospital. After some testing, the doctors found out that he suffered a spinal cord injury. This meant that he would never be able to walk anymore. Every year, roughly 250,000 to 500,000 people suffer spinal cord injuries. Only some treatments and years of physical therapy can help affected individuals to partially become mobile again. A full recovery has not been possible so far, but this might soon change. New stem cell treatments could one day help spinal cord injury patients to become mobile. My name is Kevin Steinek, and today we'll talk about how we could use stem cells to cure diseases. In order to understand how we could cure spinal cord injuries, we need to understand how they happen. As we've seen in the beginning of this video, Oliver became paralyzed after injuring his spinal cord. The spinal cord is a part of the body which enables the communication between the brain and peripheral nerves. The spinal cord is protected by vertebrae and contains white and gray matter. There are different types of neurons which have the task to send signals to our muscles for movement and transmits information from the body to the brain. Besides having neurons, we find blood vessels, immune cells, and other special cells in the spinal cord. When Oliver fell off his bike, he experienced a sudden impact on his spine. One of his vertebrae was fractured and bone fragments teared deep into the spinal cord tissue. The connections between the brain and the legs were destroyed and his brain could not send signals to his legs anymore. This is why he instantly lost the ability to move his legs. We call immediate damages primary injury. But spinal cord injuries have the unfortunate characteristic that they become worse even after the primary injury. Over the next minutes to weeks, so-called secondary injuries can occur. Secondary injuries are caused by the patient's own body as it tries to deal with the damage. You see, the bone fragments not only destroyed neurons in Oliver's spine, but also teared the surrounding blood vessels. The immune system was alarmed by the leaking blood and immune cells rushed to the site of the injury. The immune cells think that the injury might have had bacteria or viruses to enter the body and causes inflammation. Unfortunately, inflammation does more harm than good in this case. More and more immune cells are attracted and release molecules. Surrounding cells become stressed and partially die. This includes oligodendrocytes, which normally assist neurons in making transmission efficient. Without oligodendrocytes, neurons lose their insulation and have a hard time to fulfill the tasks. While the injured spinal cord is inflamed, the patient enters chronic phase. The body is so irritated by the damage that it urgently tries to repair the damages by causing scarring. Similar to inflammation, scarring can help in many injuries, but in this scenario, they do harm the patient. The formed scars can further block the formation of connections between neurons. And all of this is happening at the same time. It is important that spinal cord injuries are treated accordingly. When Oliver was in the hospital, the doctors immediately did the best they could. He received drugs which suppressed the immune system, such as methylprednisolone. At the same time, he underwent surgery to alleviate the pressure in his spine and help to reduce the damages. But another form of therapy is even more important, physical therapy. The damaged body has to be trained, and so Oliver started to work out. Besides physiotherapy, he exercised 3 times a week. This is hard work, but depending on the case, can really make a difference. Oliver really tried his best, and a couple of months after his injury, he felt a muscle in his leg twitching. You might now think, whoa, what happened there? Oliver trained so much that it triggered a process called neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity means that neurons form new connections. We've covered neuroplasticity in another video where we talked about Savant syndrome. If we work out or we do any other form of mental training, specific neurons in our central nervous system become active. If we perform a task more often, these neurons are active more and more together and start to form connections. Over time, the connections become so strong that someone who is paralyzed might regain some of his or her abilities. Although Oliver's accident changed his life forever, he tried to stay positive, and with the support of his family, he became a bit more mobile. After months of training, he was back on track in his life. If we want to find new ways to help people like Oliver, we need to fight everything that is going wrong in the body. We need to act against the immune system, which overreacts and causes inflammation. We need to support the survival of oligodendrocytes and block scarring. And at the same time, we need to get new neurons and connections. And we might be able to do all of that with stem cell therapies. Stem cells are cells which have the ability to make more and more stem cells and to transform into specialized cells. There are vastly different stem cells in the body with different functions. Stem cells in the bone marrow, for example, transform into components of the blood and immune system. Other stem cells repair the liver and help us to recover from binge drinking. If we want to replace the destroyed neurons in the spinal cord, we could use neurostem cells. These are stem cells which can transform into neurons, astrocytes, oligodendrocytes, among other cells. So in first experiments, human neurostem cells were transplanted in mice with spinal cord injuries. It was shown that the human cells survived in the animals and supported the regeneration of the spinal cord, to some degree at least. There is one issue with neurostem cells, and that is that neurostem cells can transform into different types of cells and we cannot control this transformation so well after transplantation. As a consequence, the majority of neurostem cells might transform into cell types we do not urgently need in spinal cord injury patients. And this is why many scientists try to use another type of cell called oligodendrocyte precursor cells. Oligodendrocyte precursor cells can be converted into oligodendrocytes, and these are these cells we talked about earlier. They assist neurons and get damaged by the immune system during spinal cord injuries. In 2020, oligodendrocyte precursor cells were used to treat spinal cord injuries. The cells were injected 3 times every 2 weeks, and some participants who have lost use of their hands started to get the function back. The regeneration has been quite minor, but one of the patients was able to write his own name after 3 months. Besides using stem cells though, there might be another great breakthrough in this kind of research. A couple of weeks ago, scientists have successfully treated paralyzed mice using artificial gels. These gels were made in a laboratory to mimic the spinal cord. The crucial thing here is that the gels contain special proteins which can give signals to neurons. And these signals should help neurons to regenerate while preventing scarring. So instead of injecting cells which we cannot influence once they enter the body, we now use a well-defined artificial gel. The great thing is that the gel also dissolves itself after a couple of weeks so it doesn't remain inside the body. And recently it was shown that mice which have been treated showed improvements in the survival of neurons and regained a better function. So since this study has been so successful, I guess that human trials might start soon. I really do believe that stem cells can make a difference in therapies. But of course, there are a few key questions we need to answer. For example, how can we make the regeneration really effective? How should we administer the therapy to be optimal? And also very important, how can we guarantee that the treatment is as safe as possible? And therapies will only be at the market if these 3 questions have been answered. So, you see, it is still a lot of work, but it is likely that one or a combination of therapies might give patients with spinal cord injuries their mobility back. So, I hope you liked this video, which you voted for, so what should I cover next? And also feel free to like this video and do all the other great YouTube stuff, subscribe if you're new here, hit the bell button, make an interesting comment, make a funny comment, whatever. And with that, I'll see ya. If you want to know how one injury helped a man to remember over 5,000 books, click on this video. If you want to know about potential HIV cures of the future, you might like this video.